Hello, everyone. I'm really delighted to be here today. You're going to see a sort of repetition of some themes. I was so happy I could be here to listen to what came before, and there were so many words and sentiments that I think you'll see mirrored in this and in the panel later today. I really want to talk about this notion of centeredness, which is another way of talking about mattering. I write a lot about the way male bias works in technology, in medicine, in interpretations of ideas. And what I want to talk about here is some of our assumptions about free speech and what makes a difference to people. I really want to challenge you to think, sorry, these are moving on their own, to think about certain assumptions. When we talk about free speech, we're making assumptions about autonomy and truth and democracy. And there are other ideas that go along with that, like relational autonomy, the production of truth, and representation and democracy. We have some assumptions about what constitutes safe spaces, as in our mainstream institutions are not already safe spaces. A lot of people don't think that there are lots of limits on our speech as it is, and I think there are. And I've worked a lot in the tech world where the conversation often comes down to this notion of safety or free speech. But for marginalized people, those are not in opposition. They are actually on the same side of an equation. And then the last thing that we assume when we have conversations about free speech often is that we all matter equally, which we know is not true. And so I just always go into these conversations wondering why we allow those assumptions to stand. So we talk about free speech, but we don't really talk about the law or the norms or the epistemologies, the socialization and the power that goes with them. So for example, in the law, we have things like fighting word doctrines. And I work a lot with street harassment organizations, and we know just from experience that women and men, and excuse me, two things. One is my graphics are horrible, please excuse them. And the second thing is that I'm going to have to use very binary language, and I'll get to why at the end, but it's very hard to describe historic impacts without doing that. And a lot of the research that we have is fundamentally, at its minimum, just about gender with very little intersectional data at all. So we actually have a task force working on that, which I'm delighted is finally happening. But as we gather information right now, it's elusive very often. So for example, fighting words, if I'm on the street and a man approaches me and he suggests that I do something sexual, or he grabs me and he says something, or he doesn't grab me and he says something, I am not going to respond the way a large man might, right? The fighting words doctrine is inherently kind of biased against experiences that some people have versus others. Similarly with autonomy and harm, how we define autonomy and how we define harm, we make value judgments about those things. Same thing with self-defense. The entire battered women's movement challenged this notion of how we think about self-defense. And we see all of these now over and over and over again every day in terms of the way the internet is being regulated. Similarly with norms. So we don't talk about socialization. When I think of free speech, I want to think of it as broadly as possible and think about the ways in which it's constrained socially. So children are taught to behave differently within their own homes. Now, within a home, the number one reason that that happens is gender, because very few times do class or sexuality or ethnicity matter within a childhood, right? And so girls and boys are taught to regulate their own speech, and boys are taught that disruptive speech is a marker of masculinity. Girls are taught the same thing. And so they go into the world with very different habits related to speech. Also, tolerance for violence against women. We have extremely high tolerances for violence against women. We joke about it, we ignore it, we don't have a police and criminal justice system that really treats it seriously. Offense and harms. Again, we have to define those things, and it's all based on normative experiences. Lastly, ritual silencing. In this room, I feel like everybody really understands that, but I can't stress enough how important it is to think about the ways that women's ritual silencing in religion is then carried out into the world, into the political world, into the artistic world, into civil society, and then power. Now, we kind of talk about power, but I want to talk about it in a fairly granular way and in a very specific way. A lot of the work that I do has to do with media representation. And the first kind of cut of data that we ever get is about gender. So for example, this is a pie chart that shows the percentage of professors with tenure, male and female. So 73% of tenured professors are men, generally white men, and 27% are women. It also happens to be the same percentages for executives in media companies. Lawmakers and legislators. We rank, depending on your source in this country, 72nd or 92nd for representation of women in legislators, in legislatures. We also have entertainment, films, and gaming. These are consistent, right? I mean, we see over and over again that women rarely get beyond the 20 to 25% range. And social recognition. The higher up you go, the more important the work, the greater the prestige or the status, the fewer women. So I looked at 30 different awards that are given for science, for media, for art, put them all together, and this was the result. I would argue, though, that we should think a little differently about what those pie charts look like, because we don't actually visualize marginalization when we look at it in terms of just numbers, or we look at it in terms of various graphics. If you think of it more along these ways, you get the feeling for how segregated many women end up being within their own industries. So here we are at a conference for women in secularism, right? And we have essentially done what women in other industries do as well. The thing is, these things don't exist in isolation, right? All of these social spheres exist together, and they come together, and they overlap in very meaningful ways. So what you end up with is this dense concentration of experience, of male-centeredness that, and I'm speaking very globally here, okay, because I'm going to be talking a lot about the internet, that allows men to leverage the advantages they have in each of those different areas. So if, for example, you're a woman politician and you are on the periphery of the political world, you're trying to raise money, you can only raise money from other women who have money. In theory, that's the way the models work a lot of the time. But that means you're only going to be able to raise money from 2% of major funders, right? But if you are competing with a man, he has access to men in these other realms and can go and raise funds in those ways. Or he has connections in the media world. And so we end up always being on the margins in a way that it doesn't allow us to build the critical mass that we need and the overlaps that we need. That creates super safe spaces for some people and not others, right? But we don't think of them as safe spaces. They look like this, right? Virtually every decision-making body that creates our laws and determines our norms and defines safety, harm, threat, harassment, looks like this. And to me, those are really images of collective ignorance. A lot of it has to do with this dichotomy between public and private. So women are exceedingly religious because religion was very often tied to femininity and private life. It wasn't necessarily tied to the public sphere, right? But all of these binaries really affect the way we interact and the way speech is regulated. So we have public, private, producer, consumer, credible, not credible, loud, quiet, aggressive, nurturing. We have men being knowers and women being supportive and pleasers. But I want to talk very specifically about talk for a moment. So men talk more and they talk more often. In mixed gender settings and deliberative bodies, men tend to talk 70% more than women. Women need a supermajority, so 70% or more, to reach parity in deliberative debate. Now, that's also true as a function of other metrics for status, race, ethnicity, class. But there's an interesting thing, because gender tends to trump status in other ways. So a male doctor, for example, will not be interrupted by patients, but will constantly interrupt his patients, particularly his female patients. That's not true of a female doctor. She doesn't gain the benefit of stature that comes with being a doctor. She tends to be more interrupted than a male doctor. And there are many studies that sort of point to the same things. This all starts in childhood, where parents and teachers and the media encourage these types of speech behaviors. So parents interrupt daughters far more than they interrupt sons, and teachers will ask boys more complex follow-up questions than they will girls. And so girls are substantively being rewarded for being quiet, right? They're not really being rewarded for being disruptive or creative, and that comes out in the way we teach people to speak. In media, what I found really interesting, because really it starts so early in our lives that it's very difficult to wrap your brain around how much would have to change to have this be fundamentally disrupted. But in children's movies, male characters, this was a recent study of all Disney movies in the last 50 years, male characters have 3 times as many lines as female ones. And disruptive interruptions are also written into scripts. So linguists have studied scripts, which are, of course, created by humans, and the exact same types of speech patterns are evident in scripts. The funny thing is we have listener biases. So when women in a room speak more than 30% of the time, everyone, men and women both, think that they are dominating, right? And that they're talking too much. And it's because our expectation is that they not really talk, right? And so they appear, there's also a visual bias. If a room is 50-50, people think it's overwhelmingly women. But if the room is 17 to 20% women, people think it's 50% men and women. So this I thought was really interesting because of this issue of taking up space, right? So we just had a conversation about mansplaining and about manspreading. And we see that in the linguistic dynamics of spaces like the internet. But what's really interesting is that it's not just a matter of being dominant. We're also just perceived as aggressive, just by virtue of saying things and saying them more profusely or as a group of women acting, not even in unison, but just talking together. And there was this fascinating study, 40 years of the US House of Representatives, they looked at bill sponsorship. And what they found was, yes, women tend to sponsor, quote unquote, women's issues more than men. But while a total of 4% of all bills were passed into law during this period, only 2% having to do with women's issues did. But only 1% of the bills introduced by women legislators were passed into law at all. Right? And so there's a disproportionate effect on the efficacy of women's speech in deliberative institutions. And then there's just the actual silencing that we occasionally know happens. So for example, having a state legislator, female state legislators, not even be able to say the word vagina in conversations about reproductive health, dress codes being proposed for women in state legislatures, all male panels on reproductive rights. In New Zealand last year, women legislators were asked to leave because they were talking quite openly about their sexual assaults, and this was deemed out of order. Turkey's prime minister, of course, thought women shouldn't smile, right? And so these things are happening all the time, and they might be called microaggressions, but I think that calling them microaggressions is fairly dismissive when you look at the aggregate impact that it's having on society. So we have all of these things. They come together, and nowhere do they come together as powerfully as the internet right now. The internet it's a socio-technical system, and it's making visible, I think, things that before were sometimes difficult to capture, difficult to, you know, there's always a request, especially if you're a woman, that you prove what happened to you in some way, because maybe you exaggerated or you made it up. And for the ability of the internet to actually demonstrate some of these things, I'm very grateful. But the way that a lot of these issues come out, and the way that free speech in particular is being debated, is in content moderation and censorship, right? And what a lot of people don't know is that the platforms online are being regulated, so speech is being regulated 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. These are not free spaces, these are not open spaces. There are people sitting down, and they are mainly people. It's an intensely human endeavor. It's not quite algorithmic yet. There are some algorithmic aspects to it, but we're talking about human beings who are writing rules about speech. And so the distribution of people doing those jobs really, really matters. And that doesn't mean to say that those people, each individual one, is racist or sexist or homophobic, but it does mean that the concentration of certain groups of people will end up distorting things in a way that is possibly extremely unhelpful to our freedom of expression. So for women, we know that artistic expression is censored. A lot of internet companies are really worried, like Facebook is really worried that pornography will flood its platform. So they have rules about nudity. And these rules disproportionately affect women. So a lot of the work that we've done in the last few years has done things like make sure women can post pictures post-mastectomy, or people who breastfeed can post those pictures without them being taken down as pornography. That's all okay right now. But women can't, for example, post art or political protests that contravene those rules. Same thing with political expression and sort of sexually liberating feminist speech. Male dominance, though, online and off, really means that we have a sort of hermeneutic void in understanding. We haven't even developed the language and the tools to talk about certain experiences. And so we saw that change, for example, with words like postpartum depression. There were no words for postpartum depression until there were words for that, right? There was no word for domestic violence until someone put those two words together. And we're sort of at that point now where we're trying to get words for crimes like non-consensual sharing of sexualized imagery. Do we call that revenge porn or not? What do we do with the language? How does the language matter to the law or to the policies? But the real issues are that in the tech world in particular, which is extremely, extremely hegemonically male, the issue of intersectionality and women's experiences online is extremely hard to convey. That's been changing recently, but it's been very difficult, I think. So for example, we know that Islamophobia is a huge issue. But the fact is that, as is the case on the street, Muslim women bear the overwhelming brunt of those attacks. And so what happens when you're trying to create rules for speech or policies to help people if you don't take that intersectionality into account? The other problem is that I have spent a lot of time in rooms just trying to explain to men why women might be hypervigilant, why it is that it makes a difference that we need to park our cars in certain places, or we need to put our keys in our hands, or street harassment actually is a barrier to our equality because we can't act in public space with freedom the way we might otherwise. And what strikes me over and over again is not necessarily denial, but just the fact that people don't have these experiences, so they don't know until they've had these discussions. But it does affect products and policies, and it's affecting them on an unprecedented scale, because technology companies and social media platforms are global. They are literally everywhere, and they're navigating very, very difficult legal situations across borders. But I'll give you an example, and we've had case after case that sort of follow these examples. But right now, in Facebook, there are many sexually objectifying pages that do an end run around their pornography concerns, but at the same time, a group of elderly women protesting exploitation and colonialism, you won't see that picture, right? To me, that's a very patriarchal kind of imposition of rules on women's speech. Similarly, you might see the cover of Nirvana, but you won't see a picture of Anna Mendieta, whose naked body she used for art for political purposes with a message, right? That picture on the right would be taken down for nudity. This picture is totally fine. This picture, there's no rule in Facebook right now that says that should come down. At the same time, when a man sends me a threatening dick pic, because it's a private message and not on a public wall, I can't report it, right? And so the way that our laws and our rules and our norms about harassment and harm and gender-based violence or even gendered harassment, the language of gender harassment, the way that those play out offline are infusing all of these dynamics online. So that private-public division that we know exists and is highly gendered really, really matters right now, especially because if you particularly look at young people, they're moving from public to private social. There's a lot going on in private social right now, and nobody really understands how it's being monitored or regulated or what the levels of harassment mean or what the processes for reporting are, right? So literally, I'm working on a project that maybe sounds sort of ridiculous, but all over South America right now, in particular, we're dealing with men harassing women on these platforms, specifically often by sending them pornography and dick pics in private messaging. Now, what that means is a man can send these pictures over and over and over and over again, either to the same woman or to a series of women, and there's no penalty. There's no, like, we're kicking you out of the country of X because this is not civil and because you're actually alienating an entire category of people on the basis of their gender, right? And this is happening over and over and over again. But it's not unique to a platform like Facebook. So virtual assistants, like Siri, I don't know if anybody saw this, I just couldn't get over this. If you asked Siri a few months ago to help you because you had been raped, Siri's answer was, I don't know what you mean. All right? So you could say, I was just assaulted, and Siri would say, you need to go to the hospital. But if you said, I was just raped, or my husband just hit me, and it was not just Siri, there were four or five of them, the algorithm really didn't recognize the combination of words. And that's really problematic, right? Because women are using mobile technology, very often in places where they don't even have other internet access or computers. And the fact that these machines couldn't even recognize what are really common experiences for women is staggering. But even beyond that is the idea that this is a business model, right? That the commodification of violence and the commodification of prurience are how platforms make money. So for example, if you're being harassed on the street somewhere and this guy runs by you and he lifts your skirt up and runs away, that's happened on the street. It's kind of disturbing. Technically, it's an assault, although most people won't, and often the police will just wave the complaint away. But what he can then do is film that and put it on YouTube as a prank, and a million hits later, he's made a lot of money, right? And there's no rule against that, because there are no laws against the harassment in the first place. Right? And so what we see now is that these laws, which were really based on a different time, a different set of norms, are taking on new and very complex lives online. I had one case where, this was amazing to me, we were talking about gaming, and in gaming, 70% of girls and women who game change their names to male names so that they don't have to experience harassment. But there's something interesting happening too. Boys are using gaming very socially. They play together, they're networked, and girls don't. Girls play separately. And part of that is because they need to avoid the kind of hostility and harassment that they've experienced or that they know they will experience. And I think that's really, really problematic for lots of reasons. But in this case, these are, I think, fairly common, but in one case, there was a young boy who was gaming, and he got a call from a man who said, hey, you violated our rules. I'm with this company that you're playing this game on, and I need to talk to your mother. And so the boy put his mother on, and she said, oh, how can I help you? And the man said, well, I won't report your son if you send me a topless picture of you. And so she's on the phone and she's having this response, right? And she's like, you must be kidding, what are you talking about? And he records the entire thing and puts it on YouTube and then can make money, right? And so there's infinite creativity in the way tolerance for these things in general is being institutionalized online. I won't go into each of these specifically, except to say that rape videos are sold to porn companies, right? And so there are many illegal activities in that process, but the fact of the matter is, even when they're not sold, boys are making rape videos because they know it gives them status, and they don't understand what they've done, because girls and women are so dehumanized in their estimation that getting them drunk, drawing on them, and then videotape them being raped doesn't seem to have occurred to them that this is a problem and a crime, right? So I don't advocate for more censorship. I'm a feminist. I need free speech more than practically anybody on earth right now, I think. But the lack of education about these issues in our primary schools is leading to these problems, having the kind of manifestation that causes great exponential harm. The last thing I will say about this, though, in relation to rape and pornography, is that this is an example. I was using a product. Has anybody used Ripple? Ripple is a product where you can make an automated meme. And we were making a few of them, and on one of them, and it was about the kinds of things that are said to women online. And very often, a woman, particularly if she's a journalist or a politician, will be threatened with rape. Her children will be threatened with rape. It's quite graphic. Sometimes it's pornographic imagery. And so one of the things that we had created had the word rape in it. And Ripple auto-populates hashtags for you. And it auto-populated the hashtag virgin. And I was like, okay. Was that, did I just see that? Or so I tried a couple of them, and every time you say the word rape, it auto-populates virgin. So somehow in the algorithm, these images and this language led to that conclusion. But this is really important. I'm actually gonna, I'll talk about this briefly. This just shows the gender distribution and racial distributions at the top internet companies. So you can see that it's very slim percentages of women and people of color. But this is why this is important, because really the big issue that we have right now is the power of algorithms. And we don't have systems of algorithmic accountability. And so these biases that we know exist, and this male-centeredness that we know exists, and I keep saying male-centeredness because globally that is true, whereas with race in the United States, the racial categories that we have are globally fluid, very difficult to define. There is literally no data, right? And so we need to be able to at least look at how this is working in terms of gender bias as a starting point so that we can then marry it with other forms of data. But I'll give you two examples. One is something called OpenAI, which is being developed by a group of luminaries from Silicon Valley and MIT's Media Labs, and they recently announced that they were going to be teaching natural human language to artificial intelligence. And they were excited because the database they were going to use to do this was Reddit. I'm so happy you laughed. Because I just sat there and I thought, okay, maybe there's another database that's going to be used too, right? But there was no consciousness that this was problematic and that there's such vitriol and hostility when women speak as authoritative figures in Reddit that this might be a problem, and that universalizing the speech and experiences of a group of people who are something like 75% male and 80% North American and British, is not a great way to determine what natural human language looks like. There's another tool called the Wiki Detox tool, and this is fascinating. I'm working with these researchers right now, and they are at Jigsaw, which is a YouTube subsidiary. They created an algorithmic tool that is meant to help assess hostility online so that we can maybe stop it before it gets to the end user in some platforms, right? So a newspaper, for example, might use it in comments. And they had hundreds of thousands of comments scored by lots of people. So you, if you were a scorer, you would get the list. You'd say, yes, this was aggressive. Yes, this was a personal attack. Or no, it wasn't aggressive. No, this wasn't a personal attack. And the result was that when I put in, you're a dick, which is something that someone might say, it came out as absolutely aggressive and an attack. But when I put in, you should be raped, it got almost a neutral rating, and it got a very high rating for not an attack. Words like slut or nice tits or she's a whore are the lowest rating for aggression. And the reason that that might be is because those terms are very common in our language, and it's just very difficult to determine at this stage when those constitute an attack. When you combine them with other words so that you're saying you should be raped or she should be raped, you would think it would change it substantially, but it doesn't. So this is why it matters that we understand with intersectional data who is doing the rating. Can we have control groups? Can we actually demonstrate that I might respond differently to the idea that someone is telling me one of these things than ye random dude will, right? But we don't have that right now. So if a company used this tool right now, this would exacerbate harassment for women around the world. It wouldn't help them at all. So this is the context in which we talk about free speech, but we tend not to really talk about the context at all. So I draw a lot of parallels between online harassment and street harassment because they both draw their power from these dynamics, and they legitimately draw their power from the threat of violence. So I don't, for example, respond when someone harasses me on the street with violence or with fighting words because that doesn't make sense. I'm at risk if I do that, right? 78% of American women say they have been followed by strangers on the street. Chances are they are not turning around and telling those people to go away, right? And so the same sorts of dynamics play out online. The problem is the costs tend to be pervasively dismissed, whether they're online or off, and we're ignoring the degree to which backlash is happening. So we know from a large-scale study of Guardian comments, did anybody see this study of Guardian comments? The study of Guardian, it was 70 million Guardian comments, and what they found was the top 10 people harassed, 8 of them were women, 2 of them were black men, and the topics that garnered the most aggressive and hateful speech were feminism, sexual violence, the Arab-Israeli conflict, and right up there was the wage gap. So the 10 least harassed writers happened to be 10 white men. Now, the thing is, in an editorial room, the editorial managers tend to be white men, overwhelmingly. So getting them to make the experiential leap between what's happening between them and their writers is really important. A lot of companies online are advocating counter speech. Just say something positive, say something different. And a lot of the people I work with are generating counter speech, but if you are speaking about equality, particularly if you're speaking about women's equality, there is enormous backlash. And it's networked, it's global, it's affecting women politicians who, for example, in England, there is an MP that I was talking to in May. She regularly gets intense rape and death threats, also against her children. And at one point, the police checked IP addresses, and they were overwhelmingly coming from men's rights activists in the US, not even from people in her constituencies. So when people say to me, why do you focus on women? It's because women tend to be attacked more in tandem with their other identities. The attacks are more sustained and more sexualized. almost every instance of mob attack that becomes global, that trends virally, the target is usually a woman. It's tied to intimate partner violence. A lot of non-consensual pornography and sextortion is happening. We don't have rules about sextortion. We don't have laws that can capture this technological change. And it's happening across platforms, transnationally, and it absolutely is leveraging the cultural capital of male dominance. So we created this wheel to try and capture the complexity of the problem. One of the issues is we really need to talk about the harms. So there are emotional harms, health harms, safety, harms to dignity, to civil rights, to people's reputations, their professional lives, their freedom of expression. A lot of what's happening, if you look at the yellow circle, is already illegal. So if we could be actively prosecuting what's already illegal, that would help a lot. But as is the case with stalking, that's very, very difficult to do. So when the stalking moves online and is amplified or is enacted by a mob, there are no mechanisms for dealing with that right now. Some of it is cultural, some of it is legal, some of it is technical, but it's all happening at once. So I kind of joke, and I always say that I long for a day when our voices are being silenced by political correctness, because we really we aren't socialized, we don't have the status. We live with these imbalances in power. Economic dependence is a huge issue. Violence is a huge issue, and a fundamentalist backlash that's going on right now. All online, all the time. So when I think about free speech, I think about expanding speech in response to epistemic injustice. And I think that there are various aspects of what I had described that maybe don't fit that equation, but others that are exactly pegged to what's happening. You have this gap in understanding. You have this gap in storytelling. You have this gap in assessment of harm and people's perspectives. And from the perspective of gender, that is because we are not centering women's stories or women's experiences or the costs that we experience or the costs that we incur. So I think that when I speak to students, especially when I speak to high school students and college students, in places where these debates are so fraught and so much part of their daily lives, I always say that pointing this out does not make me a victim. I'm literally describing a situation and a problem that we need to fix. Very, very complex problems. The second thing is, identifying as a feminist isn't necessarily the best thing to do in some situations, because people actually, their systems justifications kick in. But what I always do say is that at every stage, at any stage of history, feminists have always been accused of being oversensitive and of wanting to censor people. And that's happening now too. That's kind of old hat. Refusing to agree to norms based on androcentrism or white supremacy is what we're trying to do every single day. And so we need to get to this point where we think about centering people. And the internet, as bad as all of that is a truly transformational and revolutionary place, because we are able to tell our own stories, to create the kind of counter speech that we're talking about, to provide global networks of support. So when a young woman in Pakistan is petrified because someone's taken a picture of her with a mobile phone and she's sure her father's gonna kill her, there is now a support system that she can reach out to say, can you get that company to take that photo down because I'm in hiding? And that was not true 10 years ago. So I can't stress enough, even though I think everything I just told you was really depressing, I can't stress enough how much positive change is also happening. It makes it also, as I said, harder to disbelieve women. And we just have this proliferation of stories that couldn't exist before. So I don't even know if I have time for questions, but if I have 5 minutes, I'd be happy to answer any.
Maybe 2 minutes.
Okay. I'm not proposing this as the answer to all these ills, but I'm wondering, some of the women who have been exploited by rapes that have been posted and the men make money from it. Have any of them sued for their share? Have any of them used the courts to level a playing field a little bit?
So that's happened, I know, in child pornography cases, where children who were raped and turned into child porn have sued. It's very difficult. All of it's everything about it is difficult.
Of course.
For women, it's even more difficult than children. Everybody universally seems to agree that child porn is bad because children can't consent and they're being tortured, essentially. But the minute a girl starts to look like a woman or a teenage boy starts to look like a man, all bets are off because you literally can't tell. And so I think that that legal mechanism is not probably a very practical one. It's also very expensive and re-traumatizing. So there are some attempts everywhere. I mean, we have various legal task forces. There are lots of conversations about this debate between how you regulate speech or not. Right now, the best way to get a photograph taken down, if it is exploitative, is to use copyright law. You know,
well, it's copyright law, sometimes you get your share.
Right, to use copyright law. But like in DC right now, it's not illegal to take an upskirt of a woman. It's not. So when someone posts that online, there's no obligation to take it down. Right? So that's the kind of back and forth that's going on. But if a person happened to see your underwear before, it was a moment in time. Now that picture takes on a life of its own and becomes a product. And so these are very, very different rules.
You're the model, so you ought to get your payment.
Is that it?
So are any of these tech companies considering the possibility that people who aren't white men have money that spends too and looking to create a competitor that's better rather than waiting to be beaten into it?
Right. So this is very interesting. All these tech companies have their own cultures. Some are more aggressively dealing with these than others. A few years ago, an ex-Facebook employee, I think she was going to start a Facebook for women because she understood the scope of this problem, and actually it's silencing effects. I mean, right now I can't tell you how many secret groups for Hillary exist on Facebook because women simply don't want to be harassed every day of their lives on their own Facebook wall. So they're just willy-nilly creating secret groups, right? That's a self-segregation. But when this woman suggested making it, anti-discrimination laws made it impossible. She couldn't actually say. And then it gets into this question, right? All these questions we know about destroying these binaries. Are you really going to say only women can sign up? What is a woman? Who gets to fill out those fields and create those algorithms, right? And so that doesn't exist. Yes.
Sorry.
Last one.
Hi. So I'm interested in the topic of the content moderation you were talking about, which I know is extremely difficult. And I know that what you're bringing up about the algorithms is absolutely fascinating. But it's also troublesome from the other perspective because I don't know if you read a piece, and I think it was in Wired maybe a year or so ago, about the human beings that are often employed en masse. Yeah, was that your piece?
I did write one.
It was in Wired?
That's the one you wrote.
Was that the one in Wired? Well, you wrote the one in The Verge.
I wrote the one in The Verge.
The Verge, and you wrote one for Wired as well?
No, I didn't write one for Wired.
No, this is one.
I know exactly which
you know what
one
I'm talking about? Yeah.
Yes. So, it was about the trauma of being one
of
these
people. Right, right. So for folks who don't know, when you're done laughing, by the way, I didn't get it wrong. Thank you very much. It's sort of like a sweatshop situation.
Right.
Where people are exposed to some of the most horrific things you can imagine of people doing things to other people on YouTube and other things like that. And they're the ones that are responsible for being sort of the first line of defense.
Right.
To kind of keep this away from the main platform. With that as one of the, I mean, I'm sure it's not the only alternative, but as an alternative to the algorithmic approach, or as the alternative to the, you know, uniformly white males who are doing it, you know, in real life approach, just by the sheer volume of it, how do you contend with the mass of stuff that needs to get
So this is the question, right? There's really no way to contend with the massive human production on a daily basis. So the people doing this work experience huge trauma, and they churn in and out of these jobs very, very quickly. And companies that are ethical are doing something about that, right? They're providing psychological counseling, or they only allow people to use to work a certain amount of time. What's interesting to me, though, is that we're all digital laborers. We produce the effective content that these companies make their profit from. We post pictures, we write posts, we send tweets, and in return, we get whatever it is we feel we get that's worth doing that. But there is a certain level of trauma that is happening in the broader market that we're not really thinking about. So we know that, for example, with Black Lives Matter videos. We know that with rape videos, which unfortunately are more profuse than people, I think, appreciate, right?
And somehow not getting caught by these.
Right. I mean, I think now there are algorithms and there's photo DNA technology that catches child porn. But then you see what happens when a company like Facebook becomes and is a media and news provider, right? So the case a few weeks ago of Napalm Girl, where this very famous photograph that is historically important gets taken down, that got that was reinstituted because an influential man in media said this is horrible and bad. But that is happening every single day, those takedowns. You know, those takedowns are happening to the breastfeeding women, to the women who are protesting, you know, outside of Catholic cathedrals in Colombia. Nobody hears or sees about those things. And so the question is, I think of these as fundamentalist belt patriarchal norms that are regulating women's free speech, and we never talk about that. We never talk about the cost of those dynamics to our freedom of expression. And so I really, I on some levels, I can't even take a conversation about safe spaces seriously unless we start there. Because these institutions are by default safe spaces already for a certain group of people. And if we can have that conversation, then maybe we can get somewhere where it's not quite as difficult. Yeah.